Welcome back to Boulder, Colorado, everyone. Dave Towle, your friend on Zwift, with Meredith Miller. All right, Meredith, take it easy on him now. So, at one point today, Meredith, we have had the best time. We had Alex Howes at conversation pace. The group was pinning it, and he was at what, guys, 3.4?
Yeah.
3.4 watts per kilo. And he didn't even realize it.
So Eric,
who's been manning the computer all day, along with Crystal and Charlie, they were like, just would everyone just slow down a little bit?
Right.
And I think Alex was relieved. He'd just done a 4-hour training.
Of course he had.
So you just got back from a cross race.
I did. Yeah. I finished racing right around 3 o'clock this afternoon, so had a little bit of time to go back and kind of chill out for a little bit.
We heard that you are the freshly minted Rocky Mountain Region champion.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's cool. Do you get a jersey like the Rocky Mountains one?
No, unfortunately not. It'd be kind of nice if I did, though.
There you go. So, we are really happy to welcome you to the Zwift family. And I know, to be honest, you've been a part of the World Bicycling family for a long time, haven't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. You're a swam athlete, back in your day. And so, you know what that game's all about.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But this one's new to you.
Yeah. Yeah. Totally new. This is a great experience. I just tried Zwift yesterday for the first time, and I have to admit, it was pretty exciting. I had said, okay, I'm retired. I don't need to ride a trainer anymore. But of course, when this opportunity came along, I wanted to be part of it and tried Zwift yesterday and was like, this is cool.
Meredith, this is exactly what I was talking to you about before the start. This group is already blowing the pace.
Oh, yeah.
So you definitely, you're the boss of this ride, okay? So, how many watts per kilo is Meredith making right now?
Yeah, because I can't see that.
Yeah, and we'll, but
3.2.
Yeah,
so 3.2.
Okay, so I'm just telling you, we don't expect you to race everybody that wants to race you. Yeah, this is a classic women's problem in the sport, isn't it?
Oh, there, okay.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to see with my eyes, I can't see it. But Meredith, and let's just have some fun with this for a second.
Yeah.
On the bike path, when you're out there riding, you're obviously, if people see your pedal stroke, they're going to recognize you're a legit cyclist. And there's some guys that cannot hold back on trying to ride by you or ride up your wheel. Is that fair?
It's fair.
Yeah.
It happens. It happens. But, it pushes me too.
Yeah, no, totally. And I get it. And I used to love, in the day when Katie Compton would jump in with the Cat 3 man and ride to the back of the group and, sometimes win and see how far she could get.
Yeah.
I get the challenge. Steel makes the steel sharper.
Oh, right? Yeah.
So, totally understand. I mean, hey, let's be honest. You have a cool husband. I really like yours.
Yeah.
And I bet you guys like challenging each other a little when you ride.
For sure, because, he doesn't always, he has a real job and doesn't always get to train as much as he'd like to. And so there'll be some weeks where I'm on and he's off and vice versa. So I kind of laugh because when I first started riding a bike, it was hard to ride with my ex-husband at the time. And because it was a no-win situation for him.
Yeah.
He'd either go too fast and I'd get upset, or he'd go too slow and have to wait for me and I'd get upset. And
I get that. I mean, and that's a tough one, isn't it?
Oh, it's really tough.
Yeah, yeah.
It's really tough, I think, for couples to figure out. And luckily, Yost and I are a good match. Uh-huh. We're a good pair.
Yeah.
He pushes me, I can push him. We can go on the group rides and, be confident that, we're both doing our thing and able to make it to the finish. And,
you'll check in late.
Yeah, exactly.
No, I totally get that.
Yeah.
Hey, it was really nice. Unfortunately, we sat at the end of the table, did not have Eros Poli at it to hear all those stories.
Yeah.
But really nice to get together with our World Bicycle League friends and Katie and, and all the work she's doing.
Yeah.
On that note, have you ever had a chance to ride on a Buffalo bike, on a legitimate one?
I have not.
It's a 53-pound bike.
Right? Yeah. Wait, actually, I take that back. I did at Rebecca Rush's private ride on Idaho.
She
did her parade.
Uh-huh.
The very first year she did her ride,
right.
Both Yost and I were there, and we were on the bikes right. in the parade.
Yeah.
It was awesome.
Yeah, that is interesting because instead of focusing on the bike, you've got that. Don't they have a camel in that parade or something? It's a very funky.
Oh, yeah. It was going on.
I really do think there's a camel in that parade.
Very much,
for some reason.
Yeah, there could be. Or a buffalo, you know, like a real buffalo.
Right.
Or something. I don't know. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
What was your first, like, when you look back in your childhood, I'm not talking about your first tricycle, but like your first kind of legit bike, a geared bike, or a bike that Meredith wanted. Was that, did that
no,
happen
and
for you
I,
in
no.
high school?
No, not until college.
Uh-huh. And then
it was not
was
until
it a,
college.
Was it to get around Madison?
Yep. Because I went to school at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. In order to get around there, you had to have a bike or a scooter.
Right. Yep.
It was impossible.
I love a campus like that.
Yeah.
You know, that's great to make everybody ride a bike.
Yeah. And I remember I had a Bridgestone.
Okay, cool. That's a cool brand.
And that was probably...
Not
I
to
honestly
date
think...
you, but the brand was probably just about going away at that point.
Yeah. Oh, you can date me. It's okay. No, I mean, really, Dave. You can date me.
Hey,
no.
I mean, you know what? It was great with Alex because... you know, like when I was a kid, I was a fan of Andy Hansen. He's not that much older than me, but when Alec was growing up, you know, we knew him when he was 12 years old.
Yeah.
You know, he's always a big part of the community. Alex has never been a retiring wildflower, although he's not an extrovert either. You know, kind of the no Alex.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
But, I mean, if you know Alex, he's a great friend.
Oh, absolutely.
And, I mean, we can go back to, I was there in Ben when he won the U.S. Road Championship, and that had to have been, what was it, 08 or 09?
09, yeah.
Right, so, I mean, you know, even going back, remember, of course, you remember the team Sats.
Well, yes,
right,
of
that was the Danish.
I was on that team for 3 years.
Right, and
yeah.
I definitely remember you being on that team and coming over, maybe racing Philly.
Yes.
Right.
We would come over and we'd race Redlands. I think we did Philly. I remember the first year I was on Sats. We came over and we did, do you remember the Solano Bicycle Classic?
Oh, sure. Yeah, wow,
so,
that's a throwback race.
Right?
Yeah.
So we did that in Redlands back to back. So there was, I think, one day off.
Wait, Solano is one that is a real test. If someone doesn't remember that race, they weren't around cycling 10 years ago.
They haven't been around that long.
Yeah. It's somewhat equivalent to San Dimas stage race. Sometimes it's San Dimas, I think. Like, wait, was that Solano?
Right.
It was, I think, 3 days. And
Yeah, 3 days, and then a day off, and then I think Redlands was like 6 days or something. Maybe it was a whole week at the time.
Yeah.
So... essentially, it was like between the two, a 10-day stage race.
Yeah, exactly.
And then we went back to Europe in that year, and we did the Women's Tour de France. We did the Giro, and we did Tour de Lourdes.
Now, was the Giro then the Giro Rosa that we know now?
Basically.
Okay.
But the tour was way different.
Yeah, it was La Grande Boucle.
Yep.
Something? Yeah, right.
Exactly.
Right.
And the first two stages were on Corsica.
Oh, that
must have
been cool.
It was the summer of a major heat wave through Europe, like seriously, like deaths, and it was brutal. And
your team was almost entirely Scandinavian, wasn't it?
Oh, the first year, that's all it was.
Right.
I was the only non-Danish rider, and we were so new. We didn't have the resources to make our own ice.
Wow!
And for anyone who's raced or spends a lot of time in Europe, you know, ice is hard to come by.
Yeah.
So during that race, I'd go back to the team car and be handed a bottle of hot water. There's nothing you can do with a bottle. You can't even pour it over your head.
Right. Yeah.
It's just, it was brutal. And then...
I have never understood that, but why Europeans don't embrace ice more. Like, I was just in Belgium a couple weeks ago, and you had to literally kind of make a plea to the guy to give you not even a liter of ice.
When I lived in Denmark, you had to pay extra for ice.
It's just such a cultural thing. We're going to see a lot of those people coming back.
Oh, okay.
In the group, just because we're kind of finding our rhythm out there now. So, there you go.
Man,
welcome back.
Crushing it.
And Eric, how are we doing? How are we doing on the watts now? We're where we want to be. Exactly. Nice. Good. Well, we want everyone to be able to enjoy the conversation. There you are, and you're with me, as you can see. So, is this something you could see yourself doing a little done on Zwift?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, good.
Yesterday when I tried it, I was on a course in London. Started raining halfway through.
Right.
I'm like, this is so cool. Love that.
So the other one we do is Richmond. Richmond. So you do, what you really see a lot is Watopia, where we are
now.
Yeah.
Watopia is pretty cool.
Oh, it really is.
I like it.
It's actually, I think with most people, it's the most popular. And then I think London is number two. And then personally, like having been at Richmond and experienced that atmosphere, I just think it's so cool. But there's a lot of that course that is when you're going through the inner city on Broad and all that.
We are really on Box Hill.
Right.
Oh, sorry, that was London, but I didn't get to go to Richmond, so I think that would be really interesting for me to...
The part where Peter Sagana, Libby Hill is what we call the hill that we're in Richmond, and 23rd Street and Dunn Street and all that, that is super challenging, super steep, but this one, I mean, Watopia, though, is probably the best place to, well, doing something like this, definitely the best place.
Yeah, well, I was talking to a friend of mine last night, who I believe is on our ride now, Evan Fader, and he was... telling me that he's kind of the person who really does not like trainer, but for him doing this, it's really like riding with friends.
Sure.
You know, and
you can, like I was saying at dinner last night, if you want to meet up with eight of your buddies and show them at the pier, and you know, get together and go ride.
Yeah.
It's just, it's, I mean, obviously, it's such an interesting thing when you talk about the virtual world.
Yeah.
But it's pretty darn close to real, and in some ways, it makes things easier.
Yeah. Well, because Yost spends a lot of time in Taiwan for his work.
Wouldn't it be fun to ride with Yost in Taiwan?
Totally.
Yeah. And you can communicate.
Right.
As well. You know, so you have that going for you.
Yeah, I know. It's pretty cool. Last night when I was, you know, getting in a whirl, I didn't necessarily know who anybody was or whatever, but it's like, you see these people coming up from behind you, and you're like, you know, or they pass you, or you're coming up on 70, and you see, like, right now, this sprint that's coming up, or PR sections, and there's always something going on, and it distracts you from, like, you know, what could be boredom on the trainer. And,
I mean, Evan is not alone in that, that's kind of dangerous.
My brother uses it, and,
Well, great.
It's cool.
So, we were going back to the cross that you were doing earlier today. Are you going to continue with the season now?
I will race states next weekend, and then I think that's it.
How's the Colorado cross season doing?
It's good.
Yeah. Same as it always has been.
Yeah, I think there's definitely a lot of competition. You always see a lot of strong cross riders coming out of Colorado.
Boy, do we have a talented crop of young juniors. That's something, all the work that the Brandons and Pete's and Michael Robson have done, Greg Keller, along the way, it's really paying off. It shows that you reap what you sow, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah. I had the pleasure of working with the Bolo Junior Cycling Crew this week, this cross season, and let me tell you, like, those kids are good.
Yeah.
Good. And they're dedicated, and they're motivated, and they are just good kids.
I agree, and I got it.
They intimidate me.
Yes.
And I'm like, oh my God, they can do things that I can't. I'm like, what can I teach them?
Meredith, and what's cool is, sometimes it ebbs and it flows in different parts of the country, because right now, you'd go out and do, I totally remember you in Cincinnati at the Cincy Green.
Oh yeah, that was one of my favorite weekends.
The old, the Lionhearts and the Red Zone kids, they have a really strong scene there too.
Yeah.
And they also have a really good thing going up in in New England.
Yep.
And you see it, like, other regions really rising up.
Yeah.
Chicago.
Yep.
Has a really good scene now, which I didn't really see that one coming, but it's...
My brother lives in Illinois, and he goes to some of the Chicago races, and
They're one of the strongest scenes in the country.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Well, Danny, our mom, who's now here in Boulder, she came here from Chicago, and, she's a strong rider, so you can see what they're developing there, too.
Yeah, I just saw New Zealand. Like, you lived in New Zealand.
I did. Yeah. It's been...
Were you racing bikes then?
Yep. So, unfortunately, I didn't actually spend that much time in New Zealand because I was overseas racing. So I was only there in the summer.
Uh-huh.
And then either in Europe or in the U.S. for the
summer
racing.
Those were the SOX years, weren't they?
Yes.
Right.
Well, the first year.
Some sat here.
And then the second year I was in New Zealand was looked in.
If you didn't know what I was talking about, you'd be like, oh, Meredith had sats. But no, that was a, wasn't it a fitness gym?
Yes. Yeah, it was a fitness center. It was just kind of you know.
Sats must stand for something in Danish.
Scandinavian Athletic Training Center.
Oh, nice. Yeah. That's why you sponsor someone like Meredith Miller. She remembers. So, hey, our first question coming in from our friends on Twitter. And I like this question. What's the biggest difference between U.S. and Euro cross races?
Woo!
There's a lot.
I would say, so yes. I would say probably the aggression. Riders, so over the years as I've
talked
to you.
If you leave any kind of gap, book is taken.
Oh, absolutely.
In America, they might not be
able
to ride. Yeah.
There's no pleases and thank yous or sorries.
Yeah.
They're... They don't give it an inch.
Yeah.
No quarter. And here, when I talk to friends who are going over to a race in Europe for the first time, whether it's road or cross, I tell them cycling is a contact sport.
Mm-hmm.
Do
expect
not
to get
be afraid if somebody puts their hand on your hip and pushes you out of the way, or their hand on your hip to let you know they're there, or elbow out. But if you leave any sort of gap, they will take it. And they will keep coming back to you again and again and again until you finally shut the door and be like, uh-uh.
I think you're going to appreciate this. Our mutual friend, the late, great Amy Dombrowski, told me, and I always thought, I know someone had to have told her this. I know she didn't make it up.
Yeah.
But she said, you know what, Dave? In cyclocross, you got to give it like you do. And I was amen to that.
Absolutely.
You know, if they're doing that to you, and they're putting their hand on your hip and moving you off the wheel, don't be shy about doing it to her.
Because
she'll do it to you again. So,
and again.
Exactly.
You have to shut the door. You cannot be timid. You can't be shy. You can't think, oh no, I don't want to do that to this person. That's not so nice.
Yep.
You can't think that way.
You gotta do what's best for you out there. Yep. And within the rules and the boundaries of sport.
Yep.
I love that. I love how.
And the boundaries are a little blurred over there. I mean, here, for example, when you're staging for a cross race, everyone stays in a nice line, one by one,
yeah,
behind each other.
They're slotting in already.
Oh, they're staggered.
Your front
wheel is in the handlebars of the.
And are you literally hey, stop bumping? Is that
Oh no.
You just sit there and you're like, let's race.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, so, another one coming in for you. Thanks for your answer on that.
Yep.
Oh, the other thing I'd say, and we talked about this with Alex, the same sort of thing came up, is that I think the biggest difference is in America that the people going to the race are already cyclists, they're part of the tribe, you're with the converted already.
Yep.
In Europe, you're going, it's like a Bronco game.
Yeah.
You're going, it's not like the guys who are screaming their heads off at halftime in a Bronco game play football themselves.
Right.
They watch a lot of it and they drink a lot of beer.
Yep. So, what I say, as far as the spectators are concerned, Europe will have a much bigger crowd here watching, but you could have a quarter of the size here, and it will make as much or more noise than the people in Europe.
And there's a lot more positivity from the noise. And you know the other thing that is crazy to me? When the first guy or the first couple guys go by, or women, they stop watching the actual racers and they turn and watch the TV following the leader.
Yep.
And isn't that in America they hang in there? If you're in 30th place, you're still getting cheered for.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you might even, if you've got some flair to you or catch the crowd's eye, you might have every lap of them go bananas.
Yep. And I think when you guys were over here for Cross Vegas, for Jingle Cross, they got that.
Yeah.
They were like, wow, okay. There may not be as many of you, but you are cheering for all of us, and that's awesome.
Yeah.
It's really awesome. It's like, you don't feel lonely out there.
Yeah.
You actually feel like you're still in it,
I know.
Whether you're dead last or not.
Yeah.
That makes a big difference. sports.
If you want to encourage people to race and keep women or young people in the sport, that's a lot better way to do it.
Oh, yeah.
It's also really different, too, over there, that when you go, there's only going to be maybe three races that day.
Where, yeah.
You know, like a elite juniors,
yeah.
of women and the men.
Yep. And because of that, that's another big difference. The courses are a lot harder.
Right, because they're not built for
right.
Cat 5.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
No, next
they're
year,
for the elite riders only.
Right.
They aren't concerned about somebody, having an injury and suing
uh-huh.
or whatever, yep. you know, it's like, it's game on.
Yep.
I mean,
I learned that about the suing thing when you're going on the walkovers that they have for the crowd.
Yeah.
Where it's like, in the U.S., a construction, anybody who is from authority
yeah.
would say, like, shut this down.
Yeah.
You know,
oh,
like,
yeah.
this is not safe
oh,
in
yeah.
any way, shape, or form.
Oh, yeah. The number of times I have stood at the top of, like, the little drop-in or a descent in Europe and going, oh, my
wow.
God.
But in
Can
America,
I do this?
In America, they would be maybe like, that's on.
Oh, yeah. Exactly. Oh, yeah. But I get it. I mean, I get that
yeah.
here in the U.S., we are, appealing to a totally different crowd.
Well, elite sport is supposed to be about another level.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I certainly don't want to go to Coors Field and watch guys who are, my age stroking home runs out of the ball.
Right.
That should be for a very elite few human beings that are trained up and coached up
right.
and have done the work for a decade
yep.
to be there. And that's
yeah.
what I want to see.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
That's what most sports want.
Yeah, and I think the promoters here in the U.S. now are recognizing that, that the racers
well, the
pro
too. Only section
yes.
thing, that works, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
I know it's not easy. It requires more time and effort and volunteers and
yep.
workers on the course to make the changes, but it's really appreciated, I think, by the racers and the spectators
exactly.
when they get to see something that is more challenging, is more difficult. They're like, I would never do that, but it's awesome watching you guys
yeah.
do it.
Yeah, I got to hang out with Richard Freeze a couple days ago, and his race
was probably yeah.
right, KMC,
yep.
Las Vegas. Well, they put up a YouTube video that instantly had like 20,000 hits of their pro only section.
Yep.
People flipping over and a lot of passion.
Oh,
and
yeah.
it was really entertaining.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
because it's they have the courage to do it, it doesn't
yep.
always work out, even for the best.
Right.
Yeah, Stephen Hart, clips.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's amazing.
But you know those guys that are running?
Sure.
So.
If you want to scramble down,
yeah.
feel free.
Go for it.
So this is the underwater section. This long
tunnel. This is cool.
Yeah, I mean, like, so imagine the coding and the work that the guys
oh,
who have
yeah.
this have done. To,
crazy.
To, yeah, yeah. This is a lot of people really enjoy this part. I love it when you start seeing this line here, the
yeah.
water line.
Yeah.
So, okay, next question coming in. And, all right, this is one that, it's a tough one. And I think in Boulder, you guys have done a really good job. But what advice do you have for women who are just starting in cycling? Because it's an intimidating sport. And one of the things I'd like to talk about right off is the equipment element of it.
Uh-huh.
It's like, there's a lot of people who let that be a barrier.
Yep.
And so what's your advice first of all? What do you need? What do you need to get out there? And I know for a lot of people out there, you're Zwifters, you're already doing this, but let's talk about it.
Well, I think first of all, it's about finding trust with either a boyfriend, a husband, or other women, and then having a connection with a local bike shop, somebody that you trust, going in and really working with them, like here at Boulder Cycle Sport, about to find the right bike.
Uh-huh.
Because there are a lot of...
And you've got to be honest, huh?
Yes.
What you really want.
Yes.
Or, yeah, what you're doing here.
And it might take a few tries, and it might take a few test rides to find that right bike, and, talk to people, use your resources, go to, here in Boulder we have, 1020, the women's group, or, group rides will be from here, or Pro Peloton, or,
Some of them are going to be, they all have their own flavor, don't they?
Yes,
right.
Absolutely.
And so find your flavor.
Yep.
Right.
And it may not be the first one that you try.
Right. Yep.
It's like just finding as many different people as you can to talk to, different resources, and then I think getting into a group, you know, like...
Is that because of accountability? Because I've heard that from people before. It's like, with the group, if you say you're going to meet them Tuesday morning for a ride, most of us have a pretty strong personal will to not let other people down.
Yeah, for sure.
And so accountability's got to be a part of it.
I think accountability, but I also just think comfortable, like comfort.
It's just
you
cooler,
know, you just when you can ride with people you're getting to know, they're not strangers. Because of course, like I would rather ride with people than ride by myself, right? But riding in a group takes again trust, comfort. You have to...
Does the sometimes go harder than you want to and sometimes not go as hard as
you
want to? Well,
it's that and it's the pace lining, it's the drafting, you know? So you have to believe in the person, the people that you're riding with. You're going to be safe.
I'd say it's like rock climbing in that. It's like, I really need to know the person belaying me is on point. And if you're going to be running the lineup, I want to be able to trust that, you know. Same thing, like you got to trust that you're going to come off that wheel in a reasonable way. All those things that make riding sweet. It's not so intuitive.
Right.
You need to get closer.
Oh, no. Yeah. You definitely have to practice. The more you do it, the more you feel comfortable doing it. Because I think once you figure out drafting, you realize how important it is, you know, and how
much of a difference it makes when you're that far behind the wheel or that far behind the wheel.
Exactly.
Is incredible.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And, but again, you know, that's scary for a lot of people to ride close.
Yeah, and the first time that you slightly touch wheels or hook wheels and crash, if that's the moment when you really show, and this is what I think cycling is about, get back up, let's keep going.
Yep. And when you're with other women or people that you feel comfortable with, that you trust, like if you fall down and you know they're there to help you back up, like that's so important.
Yeah.
And it's also important to have those people around you be like, come on, get a little closer, get a little closer, you're good, this is safe, we're good, you know, and you know somebody's gonna point out all the potholes in the road and they're not gonna steer you wrong.
But because we're all in it together. Do you have that person, when you first started really cycling, I'm not even going to say racing, but just getting out and riding, like taking it seriously. You know, like when Dave Towle and Breaking Away starts to take it seriously.
But
was there some one person, a group of people that you related to? Was it a part of your UW experience?
Absolutely. So my first season racing was in Madison after I graduated. And I joined the famous footwear cycling team.
Oh, those monsters.
And the women on that team were absolutely incredible. And I will always go back to my experience with that team and what I learned from the first year drafting, pace lining, cornering, because we practiced it all. And that really set the foundation for my career, I think, because I can work on the fitness, but you can't go do that stuff on your own, you know? So I had that group to teach me, and I would say that one of my strengths as a cyclist was I was pretty skilled. I could ride through the peloton, I could corner and descend with the fastest riders, and it all went back to that first year and that experience that I had. And the learning, you know, the learning curve that I had that first year when I went from playing soccer to racing bikes.
I was just going to go back to that because I really think personally, and I know this is an opinion, not a fact, that's for sure. But man, if I had a six-year-old that was interested in sport, I would take them to the soccer field first.
Yep.
I always felt that, you know, maybe we go to judo, maybe we do something else, but let's give soccer a chance because I really think like the team element of that sport and the skills and the hand-eye and all of it that happens, even though you don't use your hands, you use your hands
in
a lot of different ways. And
it's a contact sport.
It really is. I mean, and you know, America gets that now.
Yeah.
The rest of the world has gotten that for a couple hundred years.
But
definitely, I mean, was that your sport when you were an eight-year-old? I see you as an athlete your entire life.
So I started playing softball when I was six.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So that was first.
I always thought softball looked fun.
He was. Yeah. I played fast pitch. I was a pitcher. Played shortstop. I played all the way up until high school. Grew up in Alabama. Uh-huh. And then in high school, it was slow pitch.
Really?
Yes.
How could they do that to you guys?
Because I know.
That's not.
Summer league was fast pitch. High school was slow pitch. I was like, uh-uh.
That's not the natural norm, is it?
I don't think so anymore.
I hope not.
No.
Really, because, I mean, fast pitch.
This is a long time ago,
yeah,
Dave.
Yeah. Well, not that long. But when you think about it, though, I mean, it's like, that's relatively crazy.
Yeah. But then in fourth grade, I started playing soccer. And that was the sport I played then all the way through college.
And did you get a scholarship with that?
No. I did. Yeah. I was a redshirt my first year. Uh-huh. And then eventually became a starting player in all Big Ten. But
I was always amazed how many of your colleagues back when you were racing on the road had a soccer background.
Yeah.
And at one point, we could have put together a full starting roster.
Oh, for sure.
Collegiate.
For sure.
Did you see Kristen McGrath? He is now a nurse.
I did. I just saw that. That's really cool. Well, and you know Carrie Higgins, who's here in Boulder, played soccer at the University of Alabama.
She's at Alabama, right?
McGrath
was Tennessee, I think, right?
Could've been.
Yeah, I have a strong feeling that's the case.
Kat Carroll.
Vanderbilt, right?
Yeah, Vandy.
Yep, right?
Yep.
She was another racer. You rode with her on Tipco, right?
Tipco and Aaron's.
Right, yeah. Those are two, both teams I really liked back in the day.
Yeah, so, but going back to like, you know, how I got started and that team I was with in Madison, it's like...
Famous footwear.
Yeah, for me, the first thing I will always tell somebody is to practice their skills.
And that's something that cyclocross has done incredibly well. When you see these skills camps, you know, I know there are people like yourself and Tim Johnson and Jeremy Powell, all the people lead these skills camps. As I know, Katie Compton does it as well.
Yep.
And they're well attended.
Yep.
And they're well appreciated by the attendees.
Yep.
I've never heard about one of those camps that, wow, it's stringing out now.
I know. Everyone's on it.
You guys are getting a little bit ramped up at this point.
Bit.
Yeah, that's right. You're smiling still.
Yeah.
And you're still talking. So that's right. Yeah. That's one of those things that Cross has really done well at, is introducing people to the sport, doing these clinics.
Yep.
Road, it's a little different.
Yeah, I mean...
You can't go to a park, really,
no,
and do it.
Yeah. But I have done clinics here in Boulder. I've done one with like 1020, where we found an old, well, not old, but an unused parking lot, like on the weekend.
Sure.
And
I think that's where my dad taught me to drive.
Yeah, right?
Right, yeah.
And we just worked on cornering. And, you know, just the technique of how you shift your weight, where you want your hands, where you want your pedals.
The apex of the,
Yep. Finding the apex. And
pedal up on the inside.
Yep.
Weight the outside, all these things.
And that was stuff, like I said, that I learned year one from the beginning. And it just made, you know, we've raced with women over the years who, man, they were strong.
But very scary.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did not know how to handle their bikes.
Yeah.
But put them on the front or put them off the front, man, and you couldn't keep up with them.
Yeah. Well, and I mean, that's an interesting thing that happens too, or at least used to happen with athletes that would transition from triathlon into cycling.
Yeah.
I mean, that was always a steep learning curve for those men and women in cycling.
Oh, yeah.
And cycling is never, by the time you get to the elite level, especially on the road, and once again, I mean, to be fair with Meredith, she is a national road champion and won that race out of a breakaway convincingly on a really challenging course. That was Aubrey Butte, right? Isn't that what we call that stage? Out by the high school, anyways, out there is where the finish line was.
It was a circuit race.
Yeah, right.
Yep.
And it was a tough, hot day. And
we knew it well because it was always the last stage of the Cascade Classic.
Right. Yep. And so then also, the winner of Cross Vegas in Meredith's career on the cross bike, and been on the podium multiple times at nationals. But you know, I think I asked you this personally off the record once. I had a guy on Twitter, a troll. Can you believe
that's
that?
A few of them, yeah. Right?
And who was giving me a hard time when I said that Las Vegas was your biggest ever career win. He's like, no, it was their U.S. World Championship. But then I think you said to me at the time, no, Las Vegas, when you had that kind of crowd, that kind of atmosphere, I mean, when you won U.S. World Championships, it was you, me, and about 20 other people that finish line.
Sure.
In Vegas,
and we didn't have social media back then like we do now. And had we, maybe it would have been a totally
That's
different
That's a really
experience.
Good point. But yeah. At that point, really, like, I think I opened my Twitter account in late 2009.
Yeah.
Right. So, right. And Facebook, if we were on MySpace, I could have hit you to a good song or two. But there's definitely, that's a timeline shift.
I don't think my Twitter account or my, text, has ever blown up quite like that before after winning Las Vegas. But wearing the Stars and Stripes jersey,
that's a good point. It's fun.
Absolutely.
I mean, I can only imagine how cool that was. Every race you went to, you knew that you were going to get called up. It was always, you were always going to get to do interviews with the local media. That's a great
The deal. Only disappointing thing about it all was that they ended up having nationals early the next year.
So I didn't get a full year
in the jersey.
This would have been you won it in August and gave it back in June.
Yes.
Right? You're like
really?
Jim? there's got to be some way to work that out.
Oh, yeah.
But I think the significance of that, I get what you're talking about, but to be able to look back and say, I was national champion.
Yep.
It's like, this isn't anything that's contested or contended by anyone other than I did.
Yep. And I think, talking about Las Vegas now, the cool thing about that was that my teammate Alan Krugoff and I had just launched this new team.
Right, yep, yep.
So it was our first race and Noosa colors, and I go out and win Las Vegas.
Boy, that must have been a great feeling, just a personal note to be able to go back to them and say, how do you like me now?
Exactly.
And
the attention that it brought to the team, and the number of people that that told us, we never heard of this before, but because of you, we're buying Noosa.
I definitely noticed that whole phenomenon that happened, and what did the Noosa people say about that?
They were pretty stoked. They obviously came back for a second year. Uh-huh. And then I think the company outgrew us.
Well, it's interesting. And what happens so often is you get a change of a marketing person who is the one that believed in you, and then they move to another brand but can't take the sponsorship with them.
Right.
And then the new person, they're already in love with NASCAR or whatever it is. And that's the heartbreak of running a team and running sports management companies and working with sponsors, is that sometimes things are just out of your control. The athletes can be great, the results are there, the vibe is there, but
they were, they've grown exponentially, and for the 2 years that we were with them, they treated us awesome.
Yeah, right.
They gave us everything we needed to do what we wanted to do.
And there's going to be a lot of talented athletes that never get a two-year block like that in their career.
Oh, yeah. And it's hard right now, I think, especially in cross.
Hit a real divot, didn't we, right now? Is it a post-Louisville effect? So much went into Louisville, and maybe we hit a high water mark. I guess literally hit a high water mark there, and then it was unsustainable.
Well, that, and I think a lot of people will say the fact that we don't have
a series. Yeah, and I would say on that note, it's not up to Joan and Bruce to keep doing that forever without the support from the industry.
Right.
And I know that the SRAMs were there, and there were plenty of people that believed in cross. I just don't understand sometimes what really happened.
I know. It's hard to put a finger on it, really.
It really is. And,
yeah.
And it's not for a lack of, if you look at the pipeline right now, there's plenty of junior riders racing, and there's enthusiasm from these kids.
Oh,
you see it every day.
Yeah.
Hey, who are the future stars of women's cycling that coming in from Twitter right now?
Well, Chloe
Dygert. Uh-huh. She's a rock star.
Ruth Winder.
Uh-huh.
There are a few of the younger names that come to mind.
Emma White is another rider. I just think it's not only her brother Curtis.
Yep.
The whole package, as far as great racer, great person, great sponsor. How would your brand not want to be involved? Chloe Dygert as well.
Yeah.
She just got married, right?
Yeah.
I love
Logan.
If you've been to cross racing in America, Well, especially more than 5 years ago, because Logan really, he won't even show up at Nats this year.
No.
But, and he used to kind of have a real limited schedule. But those are two super cool kids.
Yeah.
That you got to get.
Yeah, I was teammates with Logan on Caltech.
Right. Yep.
Yeah, and he's, you know, an incredibly focused individual, and now he really wants to make the next step to the World Tour.
I hope he does.
So, yeah, me too.
I was there when.
Now his wife.
Yeah.
He's got a lot to live up to.
Right. Exactly. And his wife is a 3-time world champion.
Yeah, I mean, she's incredible. And, you know, and Emma White, she's a two-sport rider as well on the rodeo and cross.
Podiums, 2 silver medals at the Worlds.
Yeah, that was pretty awesome for Chloe and Emma to go 1-2, you know, gold and silver at Worlds.
We were really on fire.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and having Ina.
Yeah.
Blamer directing
that. Yeah. And now that's another rider that if you're really getting into cycling now, look that name up, because
yep.
I would say not quite to a woman, because there's going to be always a dissenting opinion, but I know more pro female racers, retired, active, that say Ina is the shit.
Oh,
that
absolutely.
Is the woman like
hands
that you got to look at.
100%.
Pardon my French, by the way. We're now into our like 12-hour of
yeah, right. Strike. I think you can say whatever you want, Dave.
So, another Twitter question. What is the single biggest mistake that people make when they're starting cross racing? I think it said women, but I'm just going with people, because men... No, it said just people. Racers, it said.
Good question.
What about tire pressure? Blowing it on tire pressure?
Tire pressure, probably.
That's kind of...
I was going to say taking it too seriously.
That's a good one. I could sign up.
And the reason I would say that is because there's so much that goes into cross racing. The training, the skills. There's so many different elements that you're not going
to
get it all at once.
Right.
And if you get too frustrated with yourself right away, it's not going to be fun. It's too hard and too challenging to not learn how to have fun with it first, I think.
That's great advice. That really is. Meredith Miller saying, keep it fun, America.
Not that you can't be serious, but I think there's so much that goes into being a good cross racer that it's not going to happen overnight. And you just have to, have fun with it and like, take something new away from every single race and use your resources. Like, use the people around you to learn. Don't be afraid to ask questions.
Because in a lot of times I've seen out there, the elite riders almost feel honored to be asked.
Absolutely.
You know,
for me, that's probably one of the coolest things about cross, is how interactive the elite or pro riders are with everybody.
Oh, now watching like two little 12-year-olds in Louisville ride up to Katie Compton and ask her a question and having her really engage them.
Yeah.
I mean, those parents are just, they got to be awesome. Wow.
Oh, yeah.
We made a good call getting involved.
Yeah, don't be afraid to go up to the crews at the races and be like, so, this certain section today. What do you recommend?
Uh-huh.
But then, like, tire pressure, too, even. Simple questions like that.
Sure.
And
I'd always just say, don't be shy, but be respectful. And you gotta figure that line. And, you know, 10 minutes before the race when Katie is with her husband Mark, and that's not the time to go up and ask.
No.
Hey, so I like this question a lot because I'm a big fan of what Amgen is doing. It used to be always the breakaway from cancer and the Tour of California, but now it's breakaway from heart disease that we're talking about with the Amgen Tour of California Women's Race. So what are your opinion on AEG and everyone there really showing an investment and belief in women's racing?
I think it's amazing that, you know, they're one of, them, I think, in Philly are the only two women's World Tour races in the U.S. So the fact that they wanted to make that investment and really put the resources in and the time and the respect that the women deserve is pretty incredible.
It really is. And, and we, I don't know if it's, you know, I'm just going to say it now, the route for the women now doesn't have so much overlap with the men.
No,
great.
Because
what was happening was all of the staff, across the board, whether it's announcers or staging people or sound people or whatever, it was too much to try to do all of those races in one day.
Yeah.
And so now the women are going to get the full experience.
Right. They race 3 days on their own, and then the first day.
1 day overlaps in Sacramento.
Yeah.
Right. So the men are finishing, and the women are starting both on the same day. So that's great, in my opinion. And you and I did some announcing.
Yes, we
there.
Did.
I forgot about that. That was kick-ass.
Yeah, that was fun. Yeah, I enjoyed it.
That day worked out really well.
Yeah.
Maybe we can get you back.
I'd love to do
it. Okay, great. Another Twitter question. And we're getting down to it, folks. 5 more minutes with Meredith Miller here. What are your cross strengths and weaknesses? What were your strongest points and your weakest points of your cross game?
Well, certainly in the beginning, it was the skills.
Right.
Coming off the road or trying to do both at the same time. That wasn't something that, the skills definitely weren't my strengths. The sand, the barriers, muddy races. I think everybody will say, oh, she's such a diesel. Uh-huh. Now I have the power. Today at the race, it was basically just all grass.
Uh-huh.
And
which really does play into your extensive road career.
Yeah.
Right.
So Larry Longo, who was announcing, was like, power rider, Meredith Miller, and
Larry Longo was announcing?
Sorry.
Oh, Larry Rosen.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was like, holy cow, Larry Longo. Hey, Larry Grossman is a great, great guy.
Yeah.
Super cool. So he's saying what? I'm sorry?
Just that I was, power rider, diesel.
Right, yeah.
He's
a perceptive guy.
He gets it.
Yeah.
And so it took me a while to figure out the more technical courses.
Uh-huh.
And eventually, between, doing more mountain biking in the off season, helped me a lot to figure out the more technical aspect of it.
Were you going out with Nicole Duke a lot? That was at the end of your cross. That's when you were winning Cross Vegas, because I remember being with her and her talking about that.
Yeah. I mean, we rode together. She's a phenomenal bike handler. So
that's her real forte, coming from that crazy, the dual slalom downhill.
Yeah.
One of the most the diverse skill sets.
Yes.
Out there,
absolutely. Yeah.
I want to thank, as we're getting down to it here, you for coming out and supporting World Bicycle Relief again. And you originally got involved with WVR, where and when?
Well, just kind of...
Through SRAM.
Through SRAM over the years. Yeah. For this particular event, I have to give a shout out to Davis Finney.
Oh, nice.
He was the one who, put my name in the hat to join this event. And really appreciate that.
We really wanted to have Davis with us, but he's having some important stuff done now that we're really calling for him always. And there's no question that we love what they're doing at the Davis Finney Foundation. How do you not support the great guy like Davis? Having Andy here today was really nice. And a lot of the 7-Eleven guys. But we love Davis. So.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's cool to hear.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anything you want to put out there right now? Are you going cool? Meredith's great.
I would say retirement has been good.
Yeah, good.
And of course, retirement means different things for different people.
I saw your tweet today.
Yeah.
And I saw Sven Ness was racing today.
I mean,
you don't need to worry about it. You do what you want to do. And I think for you, getting out there and doing some cross races, it keeps you relevant in your community.
Yeah.
Enjoy it.
And I want to stay involved, and the cycling community is important to me. And
you're a lifer, man.
Well, I've been around for a long time, and I have been given a lot of opportunities. And so I want to give back.
Yeah, that's great.
And when I said that, use your resources. I want to be one of those resources for people.
So let's put that out there for the junior women, and not just in Colorado, but eventually you'll figure out a way. Go find Meredith on Facebook. If you've got kids out there that are looking for those kind of resources, a shoulder to lean on, I think Meredith is signing up for that.
the women's group rides that have been around town, and it's been fun. It's been fun to ride with women who have never used people's pedals before to other women who race.
Yeah.
And seeing that diversity of it all, but like being able to do it together, bring everybody together is pretty awesome.
Maybe Alex Howes and I decided we're going to open up a take tent.
listening to you guys at dinner last night.
So one of my ideas for you would be maybe hosting a series of women's camps throughout the year, Cross and Road,
yeah.
Skills. And,
yeah.
You know, the Finneys, Connie and Davis, did a really great job of bike camp.
Yep.
Yeah, just an idea. Yeah. Something that I think would really
work. Whether it's my own camps or being a guest at camps.
You can always put yours to work. That's a strong
He can
back,
be my manager.
Right? Yeah, right. No, it can work out great. So,
yeah.
Hey, Meredith, once again, huge thank you. We're going to sign off here from Boulder, Colorado, our last ride. Thank you to everybody for all of their help as well. But Meredith, you have that. Honestly, we had four-star guests here at Boulder, and we appreciate it.
Sure, absolutely.
Meredith Miller, WBR, Boulder Cycle Sport, and really, honestly, Zwift, thank you for everything that you've allowed us to do. Have a great time out there, everyone. I know we got a long way to go. Michael Matthews, Andre Greipel, some big names coming up. So I'm Dave Towle saying good night.